Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Mārtiņš Bitāns, and I'm the head of the Monetary Policy Department at the Bank of Latvia. And we will start immediately our first panel. And in this panel, we will try what is called the bottom-up approach in trying to answer the question that we have for this conference. We'll look at individual countries and their developments and try to understand whether these developments suggest any common patterns, common trends, and whether we can really draw also some more general conclusions from looking at these countries. And in this panel, we have some of the most knowledgeable people who can really provide really detailed and deep insights into the countries that we are going to discuss. And we are very pleased to have all these people here today. So from my left to my right, we have first the professor Michael Haliassos from the Goethe University in Frankfurt, which is chair of macroeconomics and finance. And he, this is only one of his many positions, which I will not then list today. But you can see all the CVs of our panelists in the maps and in the folders that you have. And the next speaker will be Mr. Gabriele Giudice from the European Commission. He is head of unit at the Economics and Financial Affairs. And also deputy EU chief mission to Greece. And before that, as you, most of you probably already remember him, he's been EU mission chief for Latvia. Next, we will have Professor Philip Lane from the Trinity College Dublin. He's professor of international macroeconomics. And last but not least, we'll have the speaker, will be Mr. Craig Beaumont from the International Monetary Fund. He's assistant director at the European Department, and also he's been a mission chief for Ireland since early 2011. So as you will see, really those are the people who should know really a thing or two about the countries that we are about to discuss. And we will really discussing two countries, as you can see, Greece and Ireland. And both these countries are really have been interesting from the Latvian perspective. They have been cross-checked, analyzed, and really people are having strong feelings about these countries. But really to understand better what was going on in Greece and how this has really and had an impact on what we are doing in Latvia, or maybe the opposite. And really many people are comparing Greece with Latvia, and because there are many similarities, of course. There's been deep crisis, and the sovereigns have been on the brink of default, and both these countries had to rely for the international bailout. But of course, there are also differences which are also quite notable. So it's been an interesting policy debate. There are some people who are arguing that Greece would be better off if they were doing what Latvia did, and there are some people who are arguing that it's really a different case. So, but before we go into this discussion, I think it would be good to just have a really insight of what Greece really did and what probably Greece maybe also didn't do, and what were the results so far. And for this, I'll ask Professor Haliassos to kickstart this discussion. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. So thanks very much to the governor and the organizers for inviting me to this conference. I've spent most of my career not talking about my country, and I've spent the last 5 or 6 years talking a lot about my country, so it's a change. It's a change in situation. So, my title is. I hope is the presentation on? So my title is Greece. Are we wasting a good crisis? Okay. So. The Are we showing the slides or are we just going through them? I don't know what the setup is. Do we know? Okay, but let me start so as not to waste time. So what caused the Greek debt crisis and how did we get there? And I think it is extremely important to understand that the political economy and the political process behind the numbers. So Greece, right after the Second World War, had a civil war. And in that civil war, communists lost. And yes. And as a result of this civil war, all the centrist and left of center people were excluded from the civil service. So you had to have a certificate of political beliefs to be hired to the civil service. This was followed by a military dictatorship, which was sort of fascist or extreme right wing. And after that, 1974, we had the return of democracy. And in 1981, socialists under Andreas Papandreou came to power. Now, there the choice could have been to really part with the past and to open up the civil service and the economy to everybody based on merit. But that was not the choice that was made. The choice that was made was to try to compensate those who were excluded from the civil service by giving them jobs. So civil service jobs became a little bit like a prize that was given to people who had the opposite political beliefs and were excluded before. So this had a number of consequences. One is, if you hire people like that, you don't care what they produce. You are not hiring them to produce, you are hiring them to compensate them. Secondly, you don't care how much you pay them. Actually, you want to pay them little because you want to hire lots of them. You want to compensate lots. So, but if you pay them little, you cannot be too picky about what they produce. So you don't monitor them and you don't evaluate them. So actually there are evaluation sheets for civil servants. There were evaluation sheets for civil servants in Greece, and they were all classed, determined to be excellent. So then, in addition to that, you try to build a, you influence the private sector. If you like, you corrupt a little bit the private sector as well. So you start trading, the bridge project for political support. Now, this has two consequences. First of all, you know, again, efficiency is compromised. But second, you tend to bias the private sector to become very much dependent on public sector projects and public sector activities. So you tend to form a private sector that is very heavily concentrated on activities that can be catered for by the public sector, by the government in this sort of trade, if you like, of favors for projects and for money. So that means that you tend to drive exports to a minimum. You destroy the supply side of the economy. You destroy the productive range and productive potential of the economy because it gets concentrated, the private sector gets concentrated into those few activities that can are subject to this exchange, if you like. And then you also reduce legitimacy of paying taxes. Because if you are thinking that your money goes to a government or to governments, actually, you know, it didn't matter which party it was in power, that uses the money that way, then you have less of an incentive to pay taxes. This is not to excuse tax evasion, but this is a little bit to explain part of it. So the key takeaway from this slide is not really, you know, to blame specific individuals or even politicians. The key takeaway is that Greece entered the crisis with a tiny productive sector, okay? So it was not a matter that we were not competitive in what we were producing, that we had just, you know, raised costs out of proportion and we needed to be more efficient. It was that we were not producing. So we were producing thin air, basically. Now comes, you know, the textbook, if you like, or the approach. What needs to be done in a fiscal crisis? So what needs to be done in a fiscal crisis is two things. One is to take measures to reduce the budget deficit. The other thing is to create repayment potential in the medium and long run. So you want to make sure that the economies actually are able to get on a sustainable growth path so that future tax revenues can be collected. And the deficit reduction, you know, I'm not going to bore you, there's nothing exceptional here on this list, but the creation of repayment potential, let me stress, it is to boost competitiveness, to boost entrepreneurship, to boost investment, especially in a country like Greece, where there was very little productive potential. The productive sector was minimal. What has happened? What has happened is highlighted here, and actually what is even more important is what has been perceived to have happened, okay, by the population and by economists and by entrepreneurs. And you see this list of measures, and you see that they are they have a common theme, and the common theme is that they are all, except for the very last one, improve conditions for starting and running a business, which happened only a year ago, or was documented only a year ago. All of them look bad; they look negative to the people. They look negative to the people in the country. So you massively reduce and streamline expenditures, reduce salaries, wages, and pensions. You have massive layoffs in public sector. You reduce public investment. You increase taxes, VAT, and real estate. You reduce wages and salaries. You have a protracted confrontation with closed professions. You increase flexibility in labor markets by easing layoffs, among other things. If you're trying to sell a program to people to get them to own it, this is a losing proposition. This is a very negative set of things. So this is lots of sticks, no carrot in this process. Let me highlight a little bit some of the issues here. There was an assault on household liquidity. So on the one hand, you had lower wages, salaries, and pensions. So the income side was reduced. On the other side, you had unemployment spells, and you had much greater unemployment risk. And on top of those, you had taxes on illiquid real estate. Now, some people might say, okay, maybe these taxes on real estate are taxes on the rich and liquid, and there can be some redistribution there. I'll come back to this. So here are data from actually the European Commission, the Second Adjustment Program. What you see here is the rise in unemployment, the significant drop in compensations. What is very interesting here is where this line is drawn, the forecast aspect. And you will notice that the good things, the improvements come after the line. They are in the future. So everything people have seen is on the left, and what the Commission expects is on the right, and it's much better than what people have seen. So there is an issue of communication and an issue of credibility to the population, which is a big problem. The liquidity. So here is the results of the Eurozone survey on household finances and consumption, which I'm happy to have been involved. And here is Greece versus Germany. What I do here is I rank households by net wealth. So the poorest are on the left, the richest in terms of net wealth are on the right. And I want you to note two things. The first thing that I want you to note is that real assets start at very low end of the net wealth distribution in Greece, unlike in Germany, where they start from maybe the middle of the distribution. So when you're talking about taxes on real estate in Greece, you're talking about taxes on everybody, practically everybody, not taxes on the rich. The second thing I want to stress is purple layer is liquid assets at different parts of the distribution. And if you compare Greece and Germany, you see that liquid assets are much bigger in Germany. They're a very, very tiny slice in Greece. Now, when were these data collected? They were collected miraculously in Greece the 3 months before the start of the crisis, the last 3 months before the start of the crisis. So this was the picture at the start of the crisis. So now unemployment and all the rest are eating up this tiny sliver of liquid assets. Competitiveness. There's a lot of discussion in Germany in particular, but also in other parts of the world, in which my distinguished colleague Hans Werner Sinn is extremely involved. And in his discussion, there's always a very big slide with two words on it. What is the problem with the South? Too expensive. That's, you know, these two words. And then he goes to the rest. So let's look at Greece. So these are ECB Harmonized Competitiveness Index. Comparison to 99 quarter one, right before the introduction of the euro. At different points in time, at the start of the crisis and different points in time, what's special about those points in time? Nothing. These were the points where I actually computed those. But they were different points in the crisis. What do you see here? There are only three countries in the Eurozone that have experienced an improvement in wage competitiveness, according to this measure, and Greece is the second champion of the Eurozone in terms of improvements in competitiveness after Germany, okay? If it were a problem of costs, of wage costs, the Greek exports and the Greek private sector should be booming. But it's not booming. So here is what basically has been happening. We have had a dramatic drop in the investment share of GDP. We have had a drop in imports due to impoverishment of people. We have had hardly any increase in exports, and we have had more or less stable consumption to GDP ratio after a dramatic drop in GDP. So the improvement in the balance of trade that we are experiencing is not coming from this from an export boom, but it's coming from impoverishing people and lowering import demand. That is not a promising point for the future. And you can look at comparisons that the European Commission produced, and you can see that the export performance of Greece does not compare well with the export performance of the other crisis countries. Cost of living. Again, something that is very obvious to people and that affects public opinion, if you look at food, hygiene, household cleaning items, of the 54 items recorded for the CPI, 43 items experienced price increases during the crisis. Part of the reasons, reason number two, dependence on imports of final and intermediate goods. The productive potential, the import substitution and the export potential has not been created. Now, here's the dangerous twist in the political debate. So because of this timing, if you like, because of the incredible emphasis on getting the budget deficit right and not on boosting reforms at the same time and early on, or at least not making it visible, there is enormous lack of trust in the northern partners in Greece. So the widespread perception is that northerners only care for taxes and impoverishment, not for growth, okay? There's also lack of trust in the north, saying southerners are useless. Look, we are doing all of these things for them and they're not taking off. Okay, so we are actually in a complete impasse because of this problem. Political dialogue in Greece got completely misdirected. So instead of debating what is the best way to move forward, what is the best set of reforms to implement, instead of having political parties debate that, they are debating on who is more anti-memorandum or who is pro-memorandum but, you know, not really admitting it and trying to find some excuse, yes, and trying to find some excuse for it. The Greek language is very rich. It has now gotten a new adjective. Anti-memorandum is a new adjective in Greece, yeah. So now, right now, in this political moment, every party has an incentive to say that they want out of the memorandum because the memorandum is not popular. And that is extremely dangerous. Some parties want to go back to old practices. That would be disastrous, in my opinion. Other parties want to do the reforms, want to proceed, but they find it politically unacceptable to their people to say that they want to do so. So they are trying to get out of any sort of communication collaboration with Troika. And the people are demoralized and disappointed. So here I want to just show you pictures very quickly. And I want to talk about exploitable margins that remain unexploited, things that can be done which have not been done. And they are huge. We are not talking about, you know, the second or third decimal point. So we want to encourage research and development in Greece, to identify and promote pockets of excellence, to promote investment in dynamics export-oriented firms. Salaries, let me make a point vis-a-vis Germany. The point that is very often made Greece is, and to Greek workers is, if you're going to be successful, you ought to be cheap. You ought to lower the wages. Because you are competing, you know, with the new economies in or the former Eastern European countries in the European Union, and you're not going to make it any other way. And I want to, you know, I'm thinking that Germans are competing with the Chinese, and the Chinese are very inexpensive compared to Germans. Nobody tells Germans you have to get Chinese salaries. That would not work. But what we tell Germans, or what Germans tell Germans, is you have to bridge, you know, you can earn more, but you have to bridge that differential through quality. So the made in Germany label has to be worth the difference between Chinese prices and German prices. That is a much more positive, much more encouraging message to give to people than the idea that they just have to suffer through lower wages. Promote high quality education. There are no private universities in Greece. They are forbidden in the constitution to have private universities because everything needs to be public. But of course, we don't have money to pay public university professors. So we have legislated ourselves out of the competition in the academic sphere, which could be and other export industry. I have to wrap up very quickly, but let me just show you a couple of pictures. Global Competitiveness Report. So these are opinions of over 13,000 business leaders in 148 economies. If you look at the reasons, the most problematic factors for doing business, you will see access to finance in Greece, access to financing, government bureaucracy, tax regulations. You're not going to see anywhere high wages. You're not going to see anywhere inadequately educated workforce or crime and theft or corruption or whatever else by workers. We asked the Germans, CFS runs an index, we asked the German financial sector, what do you consider as most important factors preventing you, you know, if you're going to invest in southern European countries? Wages were considered less important by the majority, but what they want is a good educational system and legal security. Exploitable margins, ease of doing business, ease of starting a business. Within 1 year, because Greece eliminated some legislation, it jumped 111 positions in the ease of starting a business ranking of the World Bank. This is what I call a huge margin. Good news is it could be done in a year. Bad news is it took 5 years to be done, right, to eliminate those legislations. How long does it take to enforce a contract in Greece? 1,300 days. The average in OECD is 529. How can you get foreign investors, but even Greek investors, to invest if this is the kind of thing they expect from, you know, in order to secure their rights? Global Competitiveness Index, Greece, position 91. What other countries are around it? Namibia, Trinidad and Tobago. Is this what you're thinking about a Eurozone country in terms of competitiveness? Gross expenditure on R&D relative to GDP. Look at Germany. You want to be dark green on this map. What is Greece? It is light yellow. 0.67% of GDP goes to research and development. About 3% of highly cited scientists in the world are Greeks, okay? The population of Greece is 0.15% of world population. 85% of them live abroad. Now, speaking of unused potential for starting and having highly successful private universities that could help in exports. Here is another striking picture. This is the relationship between the share of research and development, of GDP spent on research and development on the horizontal axis, and the share of scientists and engineers in the population. So most countries are on this nice line, and of course the size is reflected by the size of the sphere. Look at where Greece is. So an enormous share of unexploited engineers and scientists and a tiny share of GDP spent on research and development. There is a plan that members of the previous National Council on Research and Technology have constructed bottom-up map that could be used in this situation. Okay, so conclusions. The adjustment program gave enormous priority to deficits, lowering wages and salaries, and raising taxes, and very little up to now to reforms that would be visible to people and would create good jobs with attractive terms and boost productive potential. This has led to demoralization and low consumer and investor confidence that are keeping investment down, but that are also creating political problems right now. There are substantial margins for reform, allowing big improvements in limited time, but there is the danger that reforms that create productive potential and generate sustainability are not going to be made because the unpopular program is abandoned once its short-term fiscal targets are achieved without reforms being implemented. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Professor Haliassos. I think the importance of structural reforms should be obvious to everybody by now looking at this presentation. And in many cases, the conclusions, I think, also apply to Latvia. If you look at the research of developments, for instance, I notice that Greece is not alone. Latvia is in the same bright yellow club, which we don't want to be. So I think lots of things you said also applies for Latvia. But really, we have the next speaker who is really in a unique position to compare Latvia and Greek experience being actively involved in both countries. So I'll ask Mr. Giudice to compare really Latvia and Greece, and can we really compare these countries, and can we really compare the policies? So please, the floor is yours.
Okay. Good morning, dear governor, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. Many thanks for inviting me to address this distinguished audience for your annual conference. I'm really very glad to be back to Riga. It's always a big pleasure for me. Last time I spoke here in Riga, in fact, it was also for an invitation at Bank of Latvia in June 2012. The Latvian program had just ended successfully, and there were concrete hopes that Latvia would adopt the euro. So despite initial fears and hesitations, and after all the efforts that many people in this room have actually made, I'm delighted that now the common currency is a reality in this country. So as it was said before, after serving here on, as a mission chief for the Latvian program in June 2012, I moved to the Greek program, and so I became part of the Troika, which didn't exist in Latvia, in fact, because the ECB was still was not having a particular, let's say, visible role at the time. At the time, long-term interest rates in Greece were around 25%. There's just been the largest debt restructuring in history in March 2012, inconclusive elections in May, and the prospect of a political meltdown ahead of a new ballot. So that was the time where I had to shift. And I must say this has been a little bit of an intense experience the last 2.5 years. I think I got a little bit more white hair since then. But it's useful to have this vintage point to try to draw some lessons on the implementation of these adjustment programs, focusing mainly on Greece, given that most of you know the Latvian case very well, and the governor has recalled very well the main points early today. So let me talk about some differences between the two cases. So first, Greece is a somewhat larger economy than Latvia, but very much inward-oriented, relatively less integrated in the EU, despite being part of it for decades. It had an oversized and weaker public administration, a much more diversified and complex economy, society, and legislation, in fact, built over decades, contrary to Latvia, which basically was all anew. Long established position and privileges, and a strong resistance to change. The credibility of Greece had collapsed after it was discovered that budget figures had been grossly inaccurate for years. And different from here, I would say, the lack of political consensus on the causes and thus on the cure of the Greek crisis and the absence of a large parliamentary majority has also meant that the program has been continuously on a knife edge and still is, even today. So Greece was in the euro area, Latvia was not when the program started. But not being part of the euro was actually a disadvantage for Latvia, which in fact was more vulnerable and had fewer tools to fend off speculative attacks, including not having the protection of the ECB, which Greece has benefited. At the same time, being part of the euro area for Greece has been more constraining for us as well in terms of in terms of the risk of contagion, which were there on the evident, at the beginning of the crisis in Greece, given that other member states were in a vulnerable position during the global crisis. Now, some commonalities in both cases: policies were unable to handle the structural shocks that, in the first decade of the country, of the century, both countries faced. One was the accession to the EU for Latvia, and the other one was the accession to the euro for Greece. Given a weak management of public finances, made worse by the surge in cyclical revenues, lavish expenses during the boom, strong tax evasion, and high levels of corruption. These similarities have led to common developments in unfolding the crisis with a buildup of internal and external imbalances, the major fall in confidence, pushing interest rates up and capital out, a credit crunch and collapsing growth. Finally, on a more political note, these two countries also found themselves in the spotlight as a testing grounds for the stability of the European construction and the resolve of the partners in the EU to address these challenges. Now, given the scale of the challenges, it's not surprised that there was a great skepticism about the adjustment policies undertaken in the countries. Those were built around the so-called internal devaluation, as been mentioned earlier on, and the criticism were that this would not be sustainable without, you know, either cutting massively wages or ending up with a collapse of the exchange rate and the need to cut international debt. We know how Europe has reacted to this criticism. It firmly supported Latvia in the summer of 2009, and even if a debt restructuring in 2012 could not be avoided in Greece, Europe has helped Greece to retain the euro and rule out any further debt restructuring. For both countries, the Commission has been fighting very hard, both to keep the integrity of the euro, in the case of Greece, and for Latvia to make sure that the path to access it would be preserved. Now, we know that the adjustment in Latvia has been a success story, and the strong growth rates are there to prove it. Now, we are in the situation in Greece, which is a bit the situation of Latvia in 2010, I would say, where in fact a lot of policy injection had been done, but the figures were not showing anything. Actually, they were still going the wrong direction. And building on the experience, I'm quite confident that this is happening now in Greece as well. The fiscal position is now among the strongest in Europe. In fact, Greece has overachieved the primary balance target or last year, and is on course to reach 1.5% of GDP primary surplus for 2014. Given the output gap, which is very difficult to measure, but is definitely large, this means that there is a structural primary surplus of between 4 and 6% of GDP. And then thanks to a number of far-reaching structural reforms already implemented, there is now a forecast of positive growth for Greece, small but positive, and a significant pickup in 2015 and beyond. Now, the process is not over, and completing the current review, which is ongoing, will require a comprehensive package of ambitious reforms still to be identified or being agreed. But one should not misunderstand our view on the situation, that while there is a clear need to maintain the momentum of reform, there is a strong evidence that the country has now turned the corner after 6 years of recession. And against this background, given the turbulence of the recent days, one should not be scared about that, should be keeping, you know, looking at the fundamentals. There is, these tensions which are now affecting Greece in particular are largely reflecting international volatility, amplified by the very thin Greek financial markets. And there should be no doubt that Europe will continue to assist Greece in whatever way is necessary to ensure reasonable financing conditions for the Greek state and to smooth the path back to full and sustainable market access. So that's where we are now. Let me just draw some lessons from this story. First, we must do the utmost to avoid building up imbalances. The impact of the crisis can be massive, with long-lasting economic and social costs. In both cases, GDP fell cumulatively more than 20% of GDP, and unemployment went above 25%. So there should be no illusion. The restructure of the economy and the reallocation of resources when such imbalances are built has to be very large, and it will take several years. Second, we know how important it is to do the adjustment credibly. There was earlier on a discussion about demand and supply and the effect of the adjustment on interest rates and the support to the economy. Well, a credible adjustment can actually front-load also not only the expectation of growth, but also front-load the reduction in interest rates in the short term, and therefore real interest rates can actually go down much more significantly. But credibility is rebuilt only slowly over time by taking quick action to remove bottlenecks and sticking to a path of reform implementation. And we have seen several times, including in Latvia at the time, that hesitation by policymakers clearly weakened confidence. Third, we have seen that internal devaluation works, But that's not enough to sustain productivity growth if it is done simply by cutting wages. Adjustment in a monetary union is a more complex business and calls for more than a quick nominal correction. It requires that root problems are tackled head-on. In Greece, prices have taken much longer to react, and only did so when product market reforms started to take shape. Fourth, we know how adjustments should be carried out in practice. Action must be broad and well-balanced, and it must combine fiscal stabilization and structural reforms. Often, these are two faces of the same coin. Reforms of key sectors such as health, pension, education, or the public administration not only create better incentives to work or more effective and adequate services, but can also have beneficial budgetary effects. Fifth, there are many reforms without budgetary impact, which are no less necessary to attract investment and raise productivity. A less known part of the reform program in Greece, and in fact, probably 95% of the memorandum, is the work to improve regulation to eliminate unjustified rents, remove red tape, facilitate business environment, attract investors by privatizing, especially network industries, securing the stability of the financial sector, and speeding up the judicial system. Now, we have recently published a study showing how much these factors have affected the weak export performance on Greece. So all these institutional elements are really a big, big burden. And as was just mentioned, finally, there is some activity, some results coming there. Finally, rapid absorption of EU funds has also been a priority to preserve public and private investment. Sixth, and it was discussed earlier, speed and sequencing are crucial. In Greece, changes have happened much more slowly than in Latvia, which only made the adjustment more painful and longer, but not smaller. This has increased the adjustment fatigue and made the political process much tenser than in Latvia. As to sequencing, well, my position is that much has to happen at the same time. For instance, the necessary allocation of labor must be facilitated by making the labor market flexible, but this must go hand in hand with the opening up of investment opportunities, which will create new jobs, and with the development of a proper social safety net to help in the transition. On this last point, it took very long, but I'm quite proud that we managed to copy in Greece the positive Latvian experience of the 100 Lats job. And in fact, we have 50,000 temporary jobs now, which have been in Greece, which are provided by the public sector, helping long-term unemployed reintegrate the job market. And earlier this week, just to talk again about the fairness of the adjustment, a major step has also been achieved with the pilot introduction in Greece of a guaranteed minimum income, also learning from the Latvian experience and the work we've done here also with the World Bank. Finally, one should avoid scaring investors. We've been talking about investment and productivity. That only happens if people come with the money. And also if citizens, actually, they feel confident and they spend the money. So while the discussion on the devaluation of the lat was closed rather quickly, and the Scandinavian banks actually remained engaged in Latvia via the Vienna Initiative, the repeated calls for debt restructuring and the Grexit have inflicted a significant damage to the Greek banking industry, stalled the privatization process, and deepened the recession. So, ladies and gentlemen, coming to the end of my speech, I would like to draw a few tentative conclusions from the experience accrued so far as concerns the European governance. So with all our other assistance programs in the EU now over, and the Greek one nearing completion, we have now good evidence that adjustment programs have delivered, and also thanks to the joint work between the EU institutions and the IMF. However, both the programs for Latvia and Greece had a roller coaster start. It was difficult to set up sufficient funding and instruments, but also to pull together the expertise needed for addressing such large-scale challenges within EU member states. One issue for the governments, therefore, is the role of the Commission in shaping national policies. For the Commission, this crisis has meant taking up a completely new role in designing and overseeing the adjustment programs. To be honest with you, in 2008, we were neither prepared nor were expected to intervene in such depth in a member state. After 6 years, with a strong presence on the ground, now I have a team of more than 20 people just working in Greece. In the case of Latvia, we are like five. We have now made substantial progress, not only more effectively addressing budgetary and financial questions, but advising on tailoring policies across the whole spectrum of the economy. In fact, never before the enormous amount of expertise available within the Commission was pulled together in such a manner and had so much influence on policy decisions on member states. Now, we should ask ourselves whether we should go back to the much lighter Lisbon-type surveillance of the past, even if reinforced under the six and the two pacts, or whether we can find an intermediate way where policy interaction is enhanced, the Commission plays a more active role, and member states internalize to a higher degree the views coming from Europe. Further, surveillance is effective if it avoids building cost imbalances in the first place. In this context, one could consider how to move from a threat of sanctions in case of non-compliance to incentives for compliance. Dependency on disbursement has helped to push through reforms in program countries. And perhaps some financial incentives could be recreated in the context of the normal surveillance, complementing market pressure. Another lesson for governance in the EU is that the surveillance process should pay more attention to how investment and productivity gains can be restored and enhanced, how to broaden the surveillance beyond the nominal macroeconomic targets, and how to promote microeconomic reforms are further questions which Europe needs to address. In sum, there are many useful lessons which can be drawn from the recent history of Latin Greece, but also many open questions. The crisis should now be turned into an opportunity. I don't think it was a good crisis, it was a crisis. It should be now turned into an opportunity, not only for those programs, countries which have experienced a catharsis, but also for Europe and its governance process. Thank you.
Well, both of you gentlemen briefly mentioned, and I have one short question for both of you and probably also for another two of our panelists. Well, this question, there's no doubt that there's this pressure and there's willingness to exit international bailout programs as soon as possible. The underlying assumption obviously being that the markets somehow may be more forgiving and more relaxed as opposed to IMF and the European Commission. And the question is, should we be more worried about this thinking and these perceptions that markets in a way may be more relaxed? And probably a more general question is, do we see a sign that this easy money and this liquidity and this search for yield already results into the risk assessment being already altered, and we are slowly moving back to these old happy days when everybody is looking for the yield and the risk assessment was not very important? Should we be worried about these inflows into the peripherals that we are observing until recently? Or is it justified by fundamentals? What are the views?
Whichever. My view is the following. I think one should distinguish between short-term financial investments and hedge fund activities and longer-term, medium to longer-term foreign direct investment that affects the real economy in a more substantial way and develops the growth potential. I think Greece now looks quite attractive to short-term financial investors because, you know, for good reasons, because it doesn't have immediate repayment obligations because of the way the debt is structured. So I'm not particularly worried about getting short-term financial capital into the country, but I am quite worried about getting the right medium to long-term kind of capital that will develop the productive base. And for that, the reforms are needed. The reforms are needed to be visible, and also the investor confidence has to be, and consumer confidence has to be improved. I think that is lacking. I'm not so worried about ability to sell debt on a shorter term basis.
Okay.
Perhaps just one comment on this. I mean, we have, of course, we want to have money back into the countries and, finance investment. And as I said before, we need to create the conditions for the money to go there for the right investment. So just the privatization of the whole network industries would be a major scope for productivity increases.
The problem is when the money comes, but it goes in the wrong places, even for longer term, which is the construction sector, that's a problem. But okay, at the moment we have another question, which is how markets exert pressure on the governments. And just in the case of Greece, this very last month shown that, you know, as soon as there is, you know, markets can be very erratic to some extent, move and overshoot. And in the last months, there was a very clear perception, which we have seen in statements from the Greek authorities, that they could go back to the market very easily and there would be no problem. And, you know, so all of a sudden the pressure disappeared. And now, in just a question of a week, everything has changed very dramatically. So the question is, one, you know, have to be very careful on how puts himself vis-a-vis the markets, especially, you know, avoid, you know, when you are vulnerable, it's very dangerous. So that's the lesson, is avoid putting yourself in the difficult spot, and rather try to make sure that the incentives for long-term investments are there.
Okay. And in Ireland, should we be worried about markets potentially underestimating the risks, or it's all justified?
So clearly there's a big global factor in world interest rates. So it cannot be interpreted as just Ireland is wonderful, therefore interest rates are low. So that risk factor can go into reverse. So what's important is the local system recognizes that risk. So the last 2 weeks, the Irish Central Bank has announced new macroprudential measures. So in order for local households not to take on too much debt, and for the government, it is an issue that if there's a windfall reduction in interest payments, that should be used for debt reduction rather than to increase spending or cut taxes. So it's good news that the world is offering cheap money, but you as a recipient need to make sure that it's not used to increase exposure.
Okay. Okay, so we're already moving quickly to Ireland, and Ireland is another very important country for Latvia. In many ways, Ireland is used as a role model, not only because many Latvians are working there, but I think it's mostly because of its outward-oriented and very liberal economic and business model, which Latvia has tried to copy, and also with some success, I would say. So how much this liberal model has helped to overcome the crisis, I think? That's an interesting question, so I'm asking Professor Lane to just give his views on developments in Ireland, please.
So it's a pleasure to be speaking here today, and it really underlines the success of the euro area, that it's continuing to expand, and the fact that now we have such geographic coverage in Europe of the euro area. And it's also interesting that I think that the topic of the conference is interesting in picking all of these countries that have been undergoing adjustment of different types. There are a lot of similarities, I think, between Ireland and Latvia. But it's also important to emphasize some differences. So, you know, a crisis in the Irish case, and I'm sure here also, have these interacting features. It's adjusting the economy, it's adjusting the banking system, fiscal and also external. I mean, Latvia had these really large capital inflows before the crisis. We also had capital inflows, maybe to a lesser extent, but the outcome of the crisis is a lot of liabilities to foreign investors. So, you know, here, you know, Ireland essentially, as was mentioned, has had this very successful economic model since the 1990s of being basically a good location for global business. And essentially what happened between maybe 01 and 07 is there was a wrong turn. There's a wrong turn into a property bubble. So the construction sector got very big. So it's not just, you know, people working in building sites, it's banking got redirected towards mortgages. There were a lot of tax revenues from construction, which allowed the public sector to expand. So essentially, the crisis came about, and the solution in Ireland is maybe different to Greece and so on, is simply unwind that mistake.
unwind that mistake and go back to what had proven to be a successful strategy. So essentially, we had to absorb the big shock, a really big shock, of this very distorted economy, this excessively large construction sector, a public sector that had grown beyond the sustainable tax base, and again, reorientate towards the historically successful strategy of building the economy around a highly productive export sector. So the mix of activities, it was clear, would have to reorientate, even with a flexible economy. That does not happen overnight, and it's a very costly situation to go through. And also, beyond the costs in terms of labor markets and so on, there's big financial costs, essentially, for the banking system. So while, you know, the mix would have to go towards exporting in Ireland, especially, is not never going to be the dominant employer. Even in small economies, it's still the case that the local non-traded sector will always be the main employer. So you also have to have a situation where, how do you resurrect investment? Investment really went to a very low level in Ireland. It'd been so dominated by building houses, building office blocks, and in the public sector, building roads and so on. How do you resurrect investment more in kind of capital machinery and improving capacity for output? And how do you convince households to consume again? You know, the shock, it was a really unexpected crisis in many ways. Savings rates rocketed during the crisis. People became very scared about their future. And really, in terms of creating employment again, at some point, consumption would have to recover. So, you know, the story in Ireland is essentially, we had this very long sequence, increasing output. But as I say, from the early 2000s, the nature of that output had changed from highly productive tradables towards construction. So in the mid-2000s, you know, economists would look at this and say, okay, the economy is growing, but now actually TFP is negative. TFP is contracting because you're moving workers from productive activities into construction and the public sector. So the quality of that growth had changed. And then in 07, 08, there's this really rapid decline in construction. And really since the early 2010, it's stabilized, and most recently it started to grow quite quickly in the last year or so. So what you can see here is, in terms of the mix of activity, the really striking activity, if you like, is construction, the construction sector. So I scaled all of these sectors to be 100 in 97. The construction sector basically doubled, you know, went from 100 to 190. But then it's really collapsed. It went from 190 to 70. So much smaller construction sector than in the mid-1990s. And that was very rapid. So that's a big shock. You can think of all the people harmed by that. But other sectors of the economy were much less affected. So the black line is the service sector. So again, in a small economy, the service sector includes a lot of tradable services. So there's financial services in Ireland. It's the kind of social networking, Facebook, Google, all of those guys. Ireland doesn't have a big manufacturing base. A lot of the exports are services. And the other sector that's contracted is the public sector. Because again, you know, when GDP falls by a large amount, when tax revenues fall by a large amount, you have to face up to that and accept that the public sector needs to contract until tax revenues can recover. So in terms of all of the challenges there, I mean, at one broad level, you can say there was a lot of flexibility. But it's important to say, you know, it's flexible, but it's still not the case that it's like some, you know, textbook economy. There's still always going to be a lot of resistance to wage reductions. So in the private sector, it's mixed. Workers were pragmatic, unions were pragmatic. So in those cases where a firm was going to fail, workers would accept big pay cuts. But for many sectors of the economy, the firms were okay. So exporting firms are okay, and I think it's okay that those firms still, you know, if Microsoft want to share the global product, you know, profits of Microsoft, their workers in Ireland, that's great for Ireland. But then you might say have utilities or other protected sectors where they make profits and because wages are not cut, overall costs in the economy do not fall as much as you would have done under devaluation. I'm not saying devaluation is necessarily the best option, but there are benefits to devaluation, one of which is essentially in international terms means labor costs can fall more quickly than occurred in Ireland. So it's a mixed story. A fairly flexible labor market, but no way was it as flexible as in a pure textbook economy. In the interest of time, I'm not going to go through all my points here. Let me emphasize, though, about structural reforms. Ireland had structurally reformed decades before. So it's not the case there was kind of easy wins. So unlike Greece, where you can say there's so many ways Greece can improve its potential output. In Ireland, the structural reforms were, there have been, the crisis was used as an opportunity to make reforms in the public sector. So that was an interesting case. So that is one source of productivity improvements, is if you can get public sector workers to take more flexible working arrangements and so on. But that is not the story of Ireland. Ireland had a good business model, and it's just a case of going back to it. There were, in all economies, you can do better, and so the legal system could be better, some other sectors could be more open, and there have been some moves in that direction, but honestly speaking, there's been a lot of resistance. A new law might be written, but laws by themselves don't necessarily create everything that you want to achieve. So let me just emphasize about earnings. Someone earlier on looked at union labor costs. It's important to you know, be a little bit skeptical about union labor costs, because productivity is endogenous. The kind of what, you know, if you have lower wage costs, you reduce hourly earnings, you may encourage new innovation, you may encourage more productive firms to locate in your economy. And so the kind of denominator in the union labor cost calculation can respond to the wage cut. So I think that's an important element of what's going on. So if you like, in the aggregate, Ireland achieved a small reduction in wages, and its relative position has basically been improving by holding that for a number of years now. So it's a relatively slow adjustment. Let me also make the point that if you like, of course, with the euro crisis that it really ignited in 2010, 2012, this delayed the recovery in Ireland. That Ireland had already been in adjusting in 08 and 09. GDP had stabilized by early 2010. But then you had the issue about rising sovereign interest rates, the issue about the future of the euro. All of these issues meant that the recovery really was delayed for 2 years. By the euro crisis. But since 2013, recovery has been quite rapid. Unemployment's coming down quite steadily. Tax revenues are going up. So again, you have to take the international context into account. Same, I think, for Greece, that essentially it's not just Greece, and this is where the communication is an issue, is you might say to a country, well, do X, Y, and Z, and you'll be better off. But of course, the rest of the world may not have been cooperating at the right time. Let me also emphasize about credit crunch. So there is a credit crunch in Ireland, but large parts of the economy don't rely on banks. The multinational sector, they have their own financing. So just because the Irish banks are still not lending very much, that doesn't necessarily impede the recovery, because the recovery is coming from A, multinationals, and B, the service sector, where working capital needs are not so big. So different economies have different structures. I think in Spain and Italy and Portugal, maybe there's a bigger manufacturing sector that needs working capital. That's less of an issue in the Irish case. On the banking sector, you know, there's not time to go into too much detail here, But let me emphasize, and again, this is where being part of the euro area has been a big part of the story, is that essentially the liquidity provided by the euro system has been an important part of the adjustment in Ireland. There is most intense between 08 and 2011, but the numbers got really, really big. So the question is, what is the optimal duration or timing of a banking adjustment? At one level, Ireland, crystallized many of the losses up front through this asset management company for commercial property. But there's been essentially a big delay in resolving household debt levels. Now, some may argue having that big delay might have harmed the recovery. On the other hand, having a delay, a kind of wait and see approach, may mean that the total losses will be less than under a more immediate scenario. Because essentially now the economy is recovering. House prices have gone up by a quarter in Dublin in the last year or so. So calculations about the kind of total losses on long-term loans like mortgages are basically being rewritten now. So the mantra that it's always the case that you want to bite the bullet up front, may be true in some dimensions of reform, but for other dimensions of reform, a kind of wait and see attitude may be part of what's necessary. I would also point out that Latvia having a banking system dominated by foreign-owned banks, that really means the nature of the crisis is quite different, because essentially part of the losses of crisis are basically funded by the parent banks. That was partly true in Ireland. About 20% of the bank losses in Ireland were taken by foreign-owned banks. So we always thank the UK taxpayer for absorbing some of those losses. But because of the fact that there was no European banking union at the time, a lot of those losses have been borne by the Irish taxpayer. So again, now looking forward with the SSM and other dimensions of European banking union, that loop, that really destabilizing loop of having a highly open economy, part of a common currency area, having nationally funded bailouts, that is not the best way to organize Europe. I'm not going to go through the nitty-gritty of the fiscal adjustment. Let me go to my conclusions. One is, having gone through this crisis, even for flexible economies, crises are really costly. So doing everything we can in Europe to essentially lean against the wind, avoid these big boom-bust cycles in the future is important. So I think that's true vis-a-vis fiscal policy. The governor mentioned earlier on, you might be running a kind of a headline surplus, but that headline surplus might be a really big structural deficit. That was true in Ireland as well. So the idea that just because your fiscal balance is below 3% of GDP, everything is okay, that's a big mistake to make. In the banking system, having macroprudential policies so that kind of credit growth is less pro-cyclical, I think that's going to be quite important. That's right now one of the big topics in Ireland because of the cheap money available at the moment, trying to avoid a new credit boom. And making sure, the governor also mentioned the legal system, making sure you have a bankruptcy code that can work, making sure you have labor markets that can be resilient to shocks, and a banking system that's resilient to shocks. And their ownership is quite important. Having nationally owned banks means you're very exposed to national shocks. Having basically European banks which are diversified in terms of their loan portfolios, I think would be much more helpful. And then looking to the future, I think a big issue now is unlike Latvia where the debt is in the mid-40s, in Ireland it's, depending on how you count it, between 100 and 120% of GDP. That's a really high debt level, which is okay when interest rates are super low, but if interest rates ever recover, that could be a pretty big burden on the public finances. But it's a very hard sell for politicians to sell to the population. We want to run a surplus in order to guard against some hypothetical future risk. you know, whereas, you know, the political economy historically has been, if we're approaching fiscal balance, now's the time for spending increases or tax cuts. So managing debt levels, you know, is going to be very tricky to get those debt levels down. There is a part of the fiscal treaty and fiscal compact is a debt reduction rule, but I think that's yet to be tested about how politically feasible it is to implement that at a national level. But let me stop at that point.
It's still interesting, even though you mentioned that structural reforms is not that important. One of our last bullet points is still structural changes in the property and banking system are still needed. So even for Ireland, structural changes are important. Right? So as our concluding speaker, I would like to ask Mr. Beaumont to provide us with some dose of ruthless truth about Ireland. So how are things really looking from the outside?
Sorry, how do I get the presentation?
Should be in a moment.
Okay. Okay, thanks very much to the Governor and the Bank of Latvia for inviting me to Riga for the first time. I'm looking forward to seeing more of the town. So Philip has very well laid out the big picture on the Irish adjustment process. I will focus in a little bit more on the EU IMF program, and I'll try to move quickly because there are a lot of similarities with Latvia, and probably the key difference, as Philip already mentioned, is that Ireland was already in the euro area and therefore it was receiving ECB support in the process. So as is well known, they had a major credit boom and property bubble, and it was to a large extent funded on the wholesale market, and that made them very vulnerable when the global crisis came. 3 years before the program is when the economy collapsed, and that included a deflation of 8%. So goods markets were already flexible at the start of the process. They were adjusting as part of the response to the shock. But the consequence was, with an almost 20% fall in nominal GDP, revenues of the government fell basically by the same amount. And what used to be surpluses turned into double-digit deficits very rapidly. The Irish responded quite strongly. Even before the program, they took about 6% of GDP in measures. They did a lot of actions on the banking system. Some of them, in hindsight, turned out to be ill-advised, including the near-blanket guarantee, which was really based on the idea that they had a liquidity problem rather than a solvency problem. These measures did bring some stability in the near term in 2009, but markets gradually became less and less comfortable, more and more concerned about the size of the banking losses, and public debts rose very dramatically from about 25% of GDP in 2007 to almost 100% of GDP only 3 years later. So Ireland had its own very challenging crisis. But by 2010, it was joined by the emergence of the euro crisis, and financial markets were, I tried to illustrate the extreme pressure by the idea of the perfect storm. And this was came to a head in September to November 2010, when in just a few months, the outflows of funding from the banks required the ECB to provide 40% of Ireland's GDP in additional financing. So it's an extreme bank run, but by wholesale funding, which required enormous support from the ECB. So I tried to illustrate here what was going on. So within Ireland, if we look at the inner circle, there was enormous uncertainty about how much would it take to fix the banks. And that made people worry about, is the public debt sustainable? And that would affect their ability to borrow on markets. At the same time, the losses of the banks impaired the bank's ability to go to the market for funding, which made them rely on the ECB. So you have this, what's called the sovereign bank loop. But in Ireland's case, it was made more challenging by a number of European uncertainties at the same time. There was talks about private sector involvement for sovereign debt, the famous or infamous Deauville summit. Ireland was actively debating how much would creditors contribute to the costs of saving the banks, and who would pay? And there was enormous uncertainty about that. Would senior bank debt holders suffer losses or not? And given the huge size of the ECB's support and the doubts about the solvency of the Irish banks, there was also, in the market's mind, doubts about whether the ECB could keep on funding the system. And in that circumstance, there's a sense that if there's no funding for the banks, they have to shut down, it feeds back into the economy. So everything is very uncertain. And in that circumstance, the government lost market access and they had to go for the program. So what was the program objectives? Obviously, the first thing was to get out of this extreme instability, restore stability. And the next thing was to regain market access. And the key ingredients of that were sustainable public debt, financial system soundness, and getting the economy to recover. So in terms of the restoring stability, I won't go through all the details. The stress tests in Ireland in 2011 are fairly well known. They did, through the use of independent asset quality review, provide a credible estimate of the losses. And at the same time, the authorities announced a clear plan for which banks would be kept open and which banks would be wound down. So the capital need turned out to be about 15% of GDP. That was very quickly placed in the banks. The ECB made very helpful statements about this being satisfactory from their perspective. And that quite quickly slowed the losses of deposits and brought stability to the financial system. The political stability in Ireland was also very important. The government which had run the policies which led to the program was tossed out. A new government was elected in February, and they broadly accepted the program framework. They did improve it. They had a jobs initiative, and the Troika was flexible because we could see there were benefits from these changes. So what I think of most interest for this conference is the adjustment process. As Philip said, the other structural reforms in Ireland's case were not critical to recovering from the crisis. I think they are critical from medium-term potential growth, but in terms of recovering from this type of crisis, the key steps were fiscal consolidation and fixing the banks. fiscal consolidation was quite very large, it was front-loaded, but also phased over time. And I think the comparison with Latvia had a very large consolidation, it was front-loaded, but it was phased over a shorter time. So that probably is one difference. The other difference may be that the banks may have been even in worse circumstances, and quite some time was required to restore their health. So I just use this slide. It's a little bit complicated to make one point, which is the Irish authorities were deeply involved in the design of all the program policies. And there are tensions between policies in terms of improving growth versus reducing the deficit versus improving the health of the banks. And the normal response is to try and phase all these adjustments over time to reduce those tensions. The Irish came up with various safeguards. And I'll just use one example, which is that in the bank deleveraging, there was a large amount of assets to be sold, about 70 billion euros in assets. And so as not to compromise debt sustainability, they had a governance process around those sales which closely examined any sales that would be at a price below what had been assumed in the bank recapitalization. So I think it was quite innovative design of the program, and we benefited. The program is very much the authority's design. I have to mention, just on one slide, that the euro area support played an enormous role in Ireland's, the success of Ireland's program. There's a long list of support. The financing terms from the EU were improved. The ECB took a range of measures which helped stabilize Ireland's funding and improved market confidence. And most importantly were the steps towards the banking union and OMT in the middle of 2012. So in terms of results, and let's be clear, the results are the combination of the Irish policy adjustments and the European actions. The recovery in Ireland began very soon after the steps in the middle of 2012. I think those steps were very important for bringing a sense of confidence and stability, and things which had been long delayed by these uncertainties suddenly took off. Firms started hiring, you can see employment starts rising soon after middle of 2012. Investment starts rising, so you know that people delay investment while they're uncertain, and that uncertainty was taken away both by banking union and OMT. Investment recovered. Property prices started recovering. So that improvement in the euro area was critical to Ireland's recovery. I think it enabled the benefits of all the hard adjustment the Irish had done to be realized. On the fiscal side, the Irish managed to achieve deficits below the excessive deficit procedure ceilings every year. They'll do it again in 2014. What I would note may be of interest, this was achieved even though growth was lower in 2012 and 2013 than had been expected in the program. This was achieved because the Irish were very prudent in their budget projections, very prudent in estimating the impact of measures. The unsung heroes of the program were the Revenue Commission, the people who do the difficult work of collecting the taxes, but they also were very disciplined in managing spending, which was critical to the success of the program. So on the banking side, since I have only 5 minutes, I'll just note that we only need to wait just over a week when we have the reports from the ECB and the EBA, and we'll know if the banking program was adequate. But a lot of progress has been done, but the final verdict is from the ECB. So market reentry, soon after the middle of 2012, they started placing treasury bills, and you can see they go out the maturity spectrum progressively, the yields come on down. So it was very much tied to the overall stabilization of euro-era market conditions. So let's get to the lessons. Program effectiveness, this will be covered by a report due out shortly. Let me move on to the fiscal conclusions. In Ireland, in comparison with Latvia, I noted that the phasing of the fiscal consolidation is relatively long, 5 years. We felt that was appropriate for Ireland. It had already taken a lot of measures. It had set out a national recovery plan with specific measures for coming years, which were all costed. So they were a very credible and capable counterpart, which gave us confidence to have a longer fiscal adjustment. I think the benefit has been that, unlike other countries, they have not needed to change their fiscal path. So having a stable set of targets, which are difficult but achievable, has been very useful. On the banking side, there was enormous tension between our desire to improve the health of the banks while also needing to protect debt sustainability and trying to make this difficult trade-off during the program. It involved lots of discussions both within the Troika and with the authorities. My own conclusion, looking back on the process, is that sovereign market access is critical to having the banks regain market access. And so my personal conclusion is that unless you can show that some financial engineering to improve the health of the banks has a high payoff, you have to be very cautious in incurring any fiscal cost to provide support to banks beyond ensuring that they have adequate capital. So Ireland's learned some lessons from the experience, for sure. They've improved their fiscal framework, both in terms of Fiscal Council and Fiscal Responsibility Act. Big challenges remain nonetheless. They have a history of pro-cyclical fiscal policies. Can these institutions change that? They need to run large primary surpluses for many years. Can these institutions enable them to do that? And then they've also learned in terms of the financial sector, which is a very costly lesson, a long list of improvements, which includes this joining the SSM. I think, looking forward, perhaps the biggest challenge, they will develop macroprudential instruments. As Philip mentioned, they are being proactive in limiting the extent to which households can leverage themselves. Nonetheless, being a small country and a large currency area means the supply of funding can be very large. I think there will be a need for very careful management of that risk of financial expansions returning again. I think it's clear that the euro area has taken many steps for stability, including steps that will reduce the risk of banking crises and reduce their cost to the public sector. I just mentioned the IMF's suggestions on the banking union are to continue that work and to fully sever the sovereign banking linkages. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Beaumont. Well, we are running a little behind the schedule, but I think these questions that we've been discussing are worth that our time. And I think we also have some time for a couple of questions, but please keep those questions really short and up to a point, please.
Rudolf Bems, Bank of Latvia and IMF. I had a question after listening to the presenters and also to the initial, to the keynote speaker. The question is, do we have a well-defined concept of an internal devaluation? And if we do, what exactly how would you describe it, given the short amount of time we have? Because, for example, in one of the presentations, we saw that in case of Greece, there was a fall in wages, but at the same time, when you look on the export side, nothing was really happening. In case of Latvia, you had a fall in wages, and something did happen on export side as well. So, just to get your views on this topic.
Yes. Okay. Is there any more questions? Maybe we can collect if there's some more. Yes, please.
Erasmus of Bank of Latvia, a very short question. As we discuss sequence and composition of reforms, knowing that structural reforms for Latvia still are on an agenda, regarding consequence, which product and labor, and then knowing situation or comparing those countries with Latvia, on product market, I mean, sure, research and what we discussed, I mean, human capital, it's mostly a long term, you could do, but long. Have you something in mind, a little bit shorter? Very important. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And I think we have time for one more question if there is. Okay, if not, then we can probably try to answer the questions that we have. Yes, please.
So on this issue of internal devaluation, there are two steps to go from internal devaluation to increase in exports. So the first item is, you know, is unit labor cost actually lower? And this has been established also in the case of Greece and as in the other cases. There's the second step is, does this translate to price, lower price, product prices? And that has not happened. And this is partly because of, you know, lack of accompanying reforms, speedy reforms. But then there is a third aspect, which is, you know, what I try to stress, which is very unusual in the case of Greece, which is that if you don't have the capacity set up to produce more, then just lowering how much you are getting for each unit is not going to solve a problem. There has to be some, you know, this elasticity of supply. So in the case of Greece, you know, for tourism, this exists because the infrastructure exists. But if it's not producing much else, just to lower whatever price it's getting is not going to boost them.
In the Irish case, one issue, labor cost is not the only cost, but the really a big issue in Ireland in the mid-2000s was property was so expensive. Number one, a firm, it was very expensive, say, to rent offices in Dublin. So when the crash came, offices, but if you want to, so Google bought a big office building. They didn't just rent, they bought them because they were so cheap. So that's one dimension. Two is in the labor market, what counts for new firms coming in is that what wage they can hire. And hiring wages came down. So you might say you have a 28-year-old accountant or lawyer who was hired pre-crisis, still making a very high wage. And then the 25-year-old came along having to accept a much lower wage to get hired. So the hiring wages is important for that. The other element in Ireland, for tourism is also a big sector in Ireland. So there are two elements. One was they cut the VAT rate, essentially for tourism-related sectors. So a little bit like a devaluation, a sector-specific devaluation. And two is they reduced employer taxes for the low paid. So they decided not to cut the minimum wage. Now, only reduced labor costs a little bit, but they did make some effort to reduce taxes for the low paid, because the unemployment problem is concentrated in the unskilled who were making okay money on building sites. Now the question is, what sectors will hire a lot of unskilled workers? And broadly speaking, tourism is one hope. On the product, I mean, this is you can find it in some countries like Greece, maybe like trucking, that kind of thing. But otherwise, it's not so easy to point to markets where there's an obviously big return. And this is where the interaction with the banking system matters. So let's say you liberalize a sector. The impact would be bigger if new startups can enter that sector. But for a startup to enter, they have to either be a foreign firm coming in, or it's a local firm that can obtain financing. So the conditions under which product market reform is most likely to be successful are conditions under which banks are lending to new businesses. And that's where this whole issue about SMEs and so on is important.
Okay. You want comments, okay?
Yeah, I just wanted to make one comment on the internal devaluation. First of all, and also referring to your point before, I think here we should look not just at competitiveness itself, but on the external balance. External balance is exports and imports. Okay, and the contraction imports is always seen as a disaster. In fact, you know, there is also now some recent study made by Banco Latvia, I think person has gone to the IMF, looking at how preferences have changed before and after the crisis. We also wrote something about that. So, you know, there's been a boom in import, which has become, you know, has been there because of people feeling too rich, because it was, you know, credit, easy credit. So this is already per se a good correction, and I think it's going to be lasting. And so then there's the export side. Exports, good, you know, you have to improve the cost, but, you know, labor costs, in fact, are a minor part in many cases. There are energy costs, for example, in the case of Greece, are the highest in Europe. We are trying to launch now a major reform of the energy market, very long term, it will take 3-4 years, but that's the way, you know, we have to try to deliver. There's taxation, non-wage costs, which are very important, and there as well is important to try to adjust. And then, as I said before, I mean, we have also looked at this, the export conundrum in Greece. You know, the exports are much lower than they should take into account all the characteristics of the economy, and we trace this back to institutional difficulties and the business environment. I mean, it's very business licensing, any other form of competition, short-term measures in that area, they can definitely be a very big support to the adjustment. One last point is also profits are not necessarily bad. Mm-hmm. I mean, in fact, if you want investment, you must have profits in the first place. And therefore, the fact that labor costs have gone down, but prices have not gone up is per se not wrong. The question is who is making the profits? And if they are there where there are privileges and rents, and it's just there is no investment, really, that's a problem. That's in, for example, in protected sectors, that's the case, and that's why one has to really try to focus on that and make sure that profits are where they should.
Okay, I think if we have any more questions, we can discuss them over the coffee break, which is coming. But just to conclude, I think the conclusion, I think it's been emphasized many times that we've been discussing adjustment policies in this panel, but these are always necessary, the second best policies. Because once you are in the crisis, no matter how perfect your policies, your result will be less than perfect anyway. So the best policy is not to let such devastating crises happen. And of course, you can say that it's primarily the individual member states in the government which have to make sure that these crises never happen. But I think it's equally fair to say, especially in the EU context, that we also depend on the common rules and all common agreement, and we need those rules on which we have agreed to be perfectly credible, because if you have rules which are not credible, then we see it's not the confidence crisis that result, but the result may be really a real deep economic crisis. And of course, there you can also say that each individual member country must be equally responsible for ensuring those rules. But we know from previous experience that there are some countries. There are some countries which are with a bigger impact than others, maybe, and also, therefore, with a bigger responsibility for making sure that those common rules are really enforced and that we agreed and we stick to these rules. And this, I think, is one of the questions that we will be discussing in our next panel, how to ensure that we have not only rules but also stick with these rules. So I think it will be interesting discussion also in the second panel. So we will break for coffee, but please come back in 10 minutes. And if you really want, you can bring your coffee with you. And before we break, I think I have to thank once again our panelists for their contribution. Thank you very much, gentlemen.